It's the Nuclear Proctologist. It's August 15th, 2014. We are streaming live from YouTube at Beautiful Girl by Dana. And it's been a rough couple of days, and we made it, passed it, and we're on the way for it. We say hi to everybody. You know how much I love all you folks. Miss Milky the Clown, speaking of. Strontium, Don B, Rick Robinson, Automasticity, I can't even pronounce your name after all this time. You should sue me, man. Nip Killer,
it's the Nuclear Proctologist,
with a big loud voice. Nip Killer, MSVS, thank you for the call last night, bro. Lori, I'm sorry if I can't remember everybody. Missing Sky, Candace, Stacey Anderson, I see Nubru Magic was here. Stacey Anderson, of course. We love Stacey. What a sweetheart. Ellie, Lunar, Starlight. Hey, bro. Delamine, Tracy, hi. Standing Foot, Kate. Kate, you'll find Kate's links below to the Fukushima Hounds. We send you hugs, Kate. Checks and Balances, Sean Eakins, Toxic. And I'm just taking a few minutes to warm up, folks. We have people on the live stream, and that's what I mean by... Hi, John Townsend. Big Now TV, hey bro, thank you for the call, folks, everybody. Chyna, the Hounds came calling again today. Picked me up, got my spirit up and running as usual. Made a little chat with Rad Chick and Miss Milky, that was pretty cool. Got me in the spirit. Hidden Beneath, NHD, Toxic, Fix It, Ninth Wave. Oh, Spoiler, Lori, man, you got a lot of you folks here tonight, Terry Ann, Jail Whiff. JLWFTL. See, I made up a word that time. You sit. Amthers. Hi, honey. Starlight. Live Simple. Sean Can't Surf. Bert Smell. And Purple Jim, which is me. Thank you, Miss Milky, for the reminder. Yeah. Hi, folks. And so we got a good night. Hi, Elmwood. And Alex Smith. Thank you, Alex. And look what we got, folks. Whoa. Whoa. What are we talking about? Oh, that was Paulette. And that's $1,900 almost. Whoa. We also got, she threw in a carrying case and an extra batteries, all kinds of gadgets and gadgets, cards, all over the top. You talk about pretty, though. You talk about gorgeous. We're going to try to hit the beach tomorrow. And we're absolutely thrilled. I mean, you're going to have such gorgeous quality, folks. And we're going to get a couple of lenses for that, too, to make sure that everybody gets the best possible. It's really, really, we're really going to pull it off, folks. It's something else. I got a really interesting show for everybody tonight. I haven't even covered it before. And I kind of got to break the whole story down. But I wanted to really just, my shoulders are starting to come down now. And I need to say hi to everybody and get back to my basic foundation, because it's been a pretty wild ride and it ain't slowing down. Now, yeah, the camera, the memory cards, extra batteries, boxes, we need another one of those for sure. And we're sure that'll happen. We're going to leave on the 25th. And Jeff, Original Punisher, I was talking to him last night, and a number of other people all said the same thing. Of course, is I got myself... I'm not ready to go. I need another couple of days. And they're right, because it's going to take us that long to get everything else. But we are definitely moving up the scale. We are definitely getting there. Let's get on with the show, and I'll come back into the... yeah, thank you, Punisher. And I'll try to play your video tonight if I think about it, that I screwed up last night. I think I got a new desktop presenter. So the picture you're seeing is a gooseneck barnacle. It's echoing. You shouldn't be echoing. I know, Starlight, you had this problem before. We've had this problem before, remember? And you had another window open. I know this has happened to a number of people. And that's what it turns out to be. Go check that. And MSVS, Fix It Stupid, Lunar, Standing Foot. Make sure I get everybody before I get going. Yeah, I say, hi, Rad Chick. We love you too, sweetie. Thank you, honey. You're off. You know, you don't stop. I don't know how you can even find time to get here. Piano the Precious, Richie, everybody, let's get started. I think I gotta really, you know, I want to bring things into perspective to everybody, because they don't think about radiation can make it over here, and it's hard for a lot of people to wrap their mind around it. And I'm not going to go all the way down the normal rabbit hole I do go, because I decided to do something a little different tonight. We will run through some of the particulars so that you can get it. Now, another shout out is to Elaine. Now, last night, I made the mistake and called the wrong person, a huge donor. That made a huge, massive difference. And I struggled with that all night. I was gutted over that. I couldn't believe I'd done that. And I can understand why I did. But I just, something like that, I got no excuses. And so I just want to make sure she understands it. I know she doesn't expect it or want it or anything like that. And that, you know, I could have had a name written there on a piece of paper. But I don't think I even had time. It was jump, jump, jump. But I still could have done it and put it there so I wouldn't forget. Because it was important to me to say it and talk about it. And that's why I done it. And not to give credit where credit is 100% appreciated. It's just, you can't even imagine how much that is. It was heartbreaking for me. And I had a lot of time. I had a big struggle with that. And then this morning I seen your email and I felt better. But it wasn't until I seen that I felt better. It was something I realized that was just, you know, it was something I couldn't avoid, but I should have been able to avoid, because I should have been smart enough. So my apologies. You have no idea. And I learned a huge lesson, and I had a chance to reflect on things too. So it slowed me down and got me doing what I'm doing tonight. So you see that there, that light bulb, that's from Japan apparently, and that's got gooseneck barnacles on it. You normally only find them in Canada on the west coast of Vancouver Island, where we're headed in a very short while. So Japan had an earthquake and a tsunami. And I can assure you the tsunami was pretty devastating. And I'm just going to run through that for a while for us. And, you know, this is very haunting when you go down this road. And so I was pretty careful. You know, I had to take into consideration a lot of factors to try to tell the story that I need to tell. And by the time I finished getting all the pictures, I'm not sure if I can tell the story the way I wanted to, because a picture can impact you in many, many ways. And so the tsunami went through 500 miles of coastline, but a lot of people can't take it into context. And I really wanted to just at least one time spend some energy and thought and some thinking about this. And as you can see from the pictures behind me and the picture above me, they cleaned it all out behind me. But look what was above me. And look at, can you imagine what she's thinking every time she goes down that road? Can you imagine, you know, how do you live with those thoughts and sleep is something is truly, will never be understood. That whole country was traumatized during that tsunami. And as you can see, boats were deposited in the town and towns were swept to pieces and destroyed. And then the tsunami came back out. So here's some before and after pictures. And I think, you know, it's 500 miles of coastline. So it wasn't just the radiation, and it wasn't just the earthquake, and that tsunami, that legacy of that tsunami is what we're going to cover a little bit tonight. And I can't really do something like that justice, because it's unbelievable the agony that the children are still growing up remembering, and the trauma from that, and from the locals, and from their friends around the world. You know, when you look at your home and you see this, what it looks like, and you know so many of your memories are now swept away, I can't imagine. I never experienced it outside of what we all have. And you think about the desolation of this mess, you know, how it to us, we don't see it. We hear about it, we see it, and then a few weeks later, we forget about it. They won't forget about it that quick. They won't never forget about it, obviously. But, you know, I had this epiphany about all these children and implications of experiencing something like that. And then dreaming about it of, you know, listening to their friends mourn. I truly think that we, you know, we kind of lose that organic, that organic necessity that we miss on TV. And so when you sit there and you're looking at a picture, like, well, like I've been doing, you know, I spent my whole life on the ocean. And what happens if the ocean comes into your community? I can't do it justice, obviously. And these pictures, I think, they should explain to people a tiny piece of what these people, you should be able to fathom what they went through. And the courage and the fortitude necessary to persevere and try to rebuild is something I can't even conceive. How do you reconcile something like that? And that it can come again. This is something I think that, now this picture is very disturbing coming up, as if the one you're looking at is not bad enough. And so just going to ease you into this stuff. Now there's no doubt they never survived. And there was another picture at the same time. And you can see, I would imagine it's his friend or his wife is on the phone. And you're looking around and you're seeing this world getting torn apart. And you know it's for a long way. And the chance of surviving it doesn't seem logical, I would imagine. You know, and they deserve to be seen. They, you know, that deserves to be recognized for what it is just the hopelessness of what the ocean can do to you. Well, you know, we live in that world where communications is available, where 60 years ago we would never see these images. Even if they were taken, we'd have little hope of seeing it, unless it was in the National Geographic or Reader's Digest or Equinox or something like that back then, right? You can see how a community has no resemblance and how big, you know, chunks are missing. You can imagine what goes through a rescue when you're trying to rescue somebody and go looking for survivors. Or it just seems inconceivable. I'm sure a lot of these images are familiar. These planes and these vehicles could theoretically make it over to Canada and probably have some of it. We see a lot of boats coming across the ocean from that mess, that nightmare, that 500 miles of carnage and cleansing up on that coastline. And there's a lot of debris coming across, including roofs of houses and certainly boats and fishing gear. And so there's been, that's considered normal that all this debris can come over here, because that's how tides work, that's how currents work, and that's how, now this is debris field coming across, but you don't hear about it after a year or two, but that's a year and a half later now, and all of a sudden we don't hear about it. And the enormity of 500 kilometers of coastline, you know, motorcycles, this is one of the motorcycles we found up in the Queen Charlotte's, where we're headed to. You can see the debris field. I think that was the first, 2011, that was some of the estimates. And these, you know, whether they're accurate or not, is just meant to give you an idea of what we're talking about. And tsunami debris included toxic chemicals. And so you had big drums and oil barrels. You had commercial, industrial equipment wash up on coastlines. And of course, as it comes across the ocean, it disperses. But does that mean the debris is less? No. Well, radiation is the same way. And so when this all happened, there was other things that happened, of course, as if this was not enough. The nuclear power plants around Japan, 14 of them were at a lot of trouble. Three of them blew up and detonated that we know about for sure at the Fukushima Daiichi military industrial complex's weaponized isotope facility. And this, as you can see, if a nuclear plant is blowing up, of course, it's heaving this debris. Now, these debris fields went up to 5 miles high in Japanese study and 3 miles high for another reactor in studies. We think that is number 3. It could be number 4. I can't even remember anymore. They had all blown up. And just to keep you familiar with everything, number 1 looks like that after the accident. And it had 100% meltdown, melt through and melt out. The fuel pool on the top is missing. And what they done was temporarily is they put a frame around it with cranes. And then they lifted up with cranes, great big panels, and laid that around it. And now number 2, they can't get in and fix it. They can't get inside and work on it. They can't get in there and do anything, right? Because everything is destroyed. Now number 2 probably looks like it's okay, but it's not. It blew up. It detonated. The fuel pool caught fire and blew up and caught fire again. The reactor melted down, melted through, and melted out. And then you got Unit 3 and 4. And they're 100% destroyed. Unit 3 is missing. The fuel pools are actually missing. And the reactor blew itself out and all over the site when it detonated. I don't think anybody's going to argue with me about this. Unit 4 looks like that. But according to, and that's the media, and according to the media, it looks like that on the inside. Now, I want you to understand that they all melted down, including number 4, spent fuel pool. And you can go over to the nuclearproctologist.org and you can find just an incredible amount of information we have on these reactors. And at the top of the page on the right hand side, you'll see sections, and then you can go through 13 different sections. Now, of course, what they done was for number 4, they didn't put a fuel pool in there. No, not at all. What they done was they built a structure alongside of it, and they built it up, and then they built it across. And let me give you a good picture of that. But it doesn't touch the buildings. It doesn't support the buildings, and they never went inside the building. But apparently, inside of the building, it looks like that. And if you look up at the building itself, let's have a look, another look at the building. Now inside of that building, at the roof of it, how should it look if you're inside of the building? Should it look like this? Well, it doesn't. And it can't. And it hasn't. And they never went in there and fixed it. So why were they lying about it? So they were trying to give people a distraction so they wouldn't think about the Pacific Ocean. So they built a structure up and across it, but they never went inside of it. You can't get inside and work on it. Now, if the fuel pool looked like that on the inside, there's no reason to build a structure alongside of it. Can we all at least agree up on that? And so let me keep jumping back to the tsunami debris before I forget what I'm doing here. But I need to cover all the reactors so you have a good handle on it. And we'll cover it a little bit more before the video is over. But just remember, the buildings don't touch each other for a reason, because the other building's too unstable. So if it's so unstable, how could they get inside of it? And if it's so perfect on the inside of it, what's the rush? I'm not sure if they realize it, but they got another melted reactor, or 2, or 3, you know what I mean? They're all melted. I'm not saying or, but I'm saying they can go either, meeny, meeny, miny, mo, rather than bother with something that looks like they should be having a dance or a sock up or something. Because I can assure you, the roof does not look like that inside of that building. Right, that's number 4. And that's the official TEPCO website. You can run over before they take the picture down, because we call them out, and you'll see this. But if you want, you can just go over to all the media, and they'll show you the same picture and say, no, that's what they're doing. But you need to understand that all they done was they built a structure, a construct, up and across it, right? And so if that's all they done, and the building really truly did blow up, we're not making that one up. No, the building actually blew up. That was a 10-story building that's missing. So let me come back over to the tsunami debris. And so the tsunami, you can see the picture behind me from a plane shot. And you can see across from me some that showed up on the coastline. I can show you another couple of shots of what we're talking about coming across the ocean. But apparently, radiation can't cross the ocean for a lot of people. And after 3.5 years, they seem to ignore the debris or notice the debris and forget about the radiation that is hemorrhaging into the ocean from all those reactors I showed you. 1,440 minutes a day, about 1,000 to 4,000 pounds. Now, some of the debris that's coming over, I'll give you another picture. Now, that the one I'm showing you behind me is radiation in the ocean. That's only based upon cesium-137. And whenever you see cesium-137, you have to calibrate that it's 90 times to 100 times more strontium-90. And that all the other radioactive elements and isotopes and atoms and particles that are created through the chain reaction of an unhinged meltdowns, triple meltdowns, it's unprecedented. And so they hid the ocean away from you. But it's not just that we want to cover the story, but I need to explain that to you. That as I go up, this is British Columbia's coastline, this is debris from Fukushima that has been found on that coastline, and we will see that. But we can't take the DNA of that, and we probably are going to only find the 4 species all the way up. But then at least we can have a debate. Lots of boats have showed up. I got so many pictures, I'm able to pair them all up. Big docks have shown up on the coastline of California. And once again, all that debris that walked out. And at the same time, you think about the debris that was left. I mean, that is stunning. That is unimaginably stunning. And to me, everything is heartbreak. Every piece of everything I see there belongs to somebody's home. Of course, that was somebody's bike. Right. And you can see what the before and after pictures can be if it shows up. Because you're talking about stuff, you're talking about a debris field size of Texas, right? So a debris field the size of Texas, you can make every community on the coastline look like that. And then it's got all the toxic stuff that came with it, right? So it would have all that toxic debris that came with it. And I mean, that could really mess up the coastline. So we could have lost the coastline, a lot of the coastline from stuff like that. And so losing the coastline to the ocean, I know that the other stuff is not going to kill all the faunas and the floras and thousands of species just in certain areas, not counting the millions that are in the ocean. But I'm just saying tragedy is always at our fingertips. But this time it's something different. This time is something we are, it's not like bananas, it's not like potato chips. It's not like walking in the sunshine. That's radiation really truly is not like that. And you've been fed that for 70 years, depending on your age. And of course, you can see the before and after pictures of areas. And this one here, the bottom picture, that's the before. And then as you go up, you can see the carnage all around me. These are, people lost their pets and their children, of course, and their entire history and their family and their life savings. And 500 miles of that. And it's such a burden. It's such a burden. And to have the radiation upon that country is so disheartening. And that's why the nuclearproctologist.org exists, so people can go there. And this next picture, of course, it speaks for itself. One can only imagine, that somebody picked out those curtains and somebody's personal possessions are still in that house. It's an unimaginable sight. It must have been an apocalyptic sight when it happened. It's inconceivable, you know, that the children that we don't think about, that are traumatized and scarred forever, and they got no one to help them, and at the same time they're being irradiated by their own government with no mercy, with no forgiveness. And so never think for a second that your system won't turn its back on you. Because Japan should be, when they had their most troubles, it's when they turned their back on everybody and went to save the nuclear mass murdering machine rather than their own people. They actually truly did that. They were more interested in saving the nuclear industry and its reputation that it doesn't deserve, it should never have, and it only has because of people whose jobs depend upon it, 2 million corporations. And you can imagine, you know, that debris showing up on your coastline, let alone starting from your coastline. Both sides of the coin still have repercussions, of course, but Japan suffered. We have to speak up for Japan. And like, the ocean is dead. And I'm not covering that so much tonight at all, because it's been a rough couple of weeks for us, and we're about to go that route again. But I wanted to reflect and bring everybody back to when this all happened. And then for the people that don't understand how the ocean works, they can kind of start to grasp that not only will the pollution come across in a short period of time in a large amounts, but the radiation that after 130 days it hit the coastline, the other coastline here, and every day behind it was another plume of 1,440 little plumes of 50 cubic miles for 1,300 days. And the model behind me is based upon cesium-137. Once again, it doesn't travel by itself. And then the urethane peroxide, hydrogen, sulfur buckyballs that were created. And I'll come over to the desktop and just run over, kind of help people sort out that part a bit better. And let me see what I got for us. Dana, cancer, Fukushima eclipse, reactors, rain from leftover files, buckyballs. Hey buddy, let me bring up some pictures and hope this works out. Prime Minister ordered halt to cooling after he was advised seawater could cause a chain reaction or create criticality, May the 21st, 2011. They were spraying salt water on the reactor, and the salt water, right, this is what you see, they've done for 40 days, create these spherical shapes. And these shapes ingest atoms and particles and become like little nuclear engines. And they're not solutable in water, and they bind to like rocks and gravel and dirt and stuff like that. And what that means is, and I'll cover that in a bit, but that's an important part for you to understand, that these buckyballs, because they put salt water on it for so long, it broke down the integrity of all the structures, of all the zirconian cladding, of all the mechanical parts that would have been normally usable, became unusable and inoperable, and that the degradation and deterioration was enhanced and expedited. Now, that part to a lot of people escapes them, but these balls are less than 1/10,000th of a millionth of a meter. And these are not hot buckyballs, these are super friggin' hot buckyballs. And what they do, and I should make those pictures bigger, what they do is you ingest them. And that's why I you know, this is what I want the future to be looking like in a perfect world that doesn't exist, but we are going to try to create, is that we have a good old-fashioned GMO burning party, and everybody comes on board, and then we take all the genetically modified creature scientists, and we get them to find out the ways to put this in a sarcophagus, the GMO. And then every community distributes organic seeds into the mail immediately to all the homes and encourages them to go out and plant their foods everywhere, and that no one's allowed to use pesticides anymore because we need insects more than ever. And then everybody can start building up nutrients in their body because the genetically modified critters that are in all your supermarkets and corner shops are making you susceptible and vulnerable. And so it's so important that we get our own way here on debt for them to have a sign of good faith. Because if not, then people won't have any trust in the system. That if they're not willing to get rid of the GMO and stop it and just stop doing what they're doing, then we have no need for them. We can do it without them. We'll just get rid of them. And we'll get on with our society without them. And we won't stop till they're all gone. Because that's what will happen with society if they don't have hope. But there won't be nothing after. But if we have a collective thought throughout this planet that there is an opportunity to try to take 4,300 peer-reviewed academic studies every day and create solutions and get rid of, throw off the shackles that are going to drown us against our all the species on the planet is what this is going to destroy. Everything. They've gone too far. Their own children won't even be able to look at them when they find out just what is happening to the ocean. I digressed. These spherical buckyballs created by spraying salt water on the ocean and then hemorrhaging into the ocean and then causing the deterioration and the fuel in the ocean is creating these buckyballs from the detonations, from splitting the atoms and from the contact of the rods that were blown over that site from the three melted reactors and detonated melt-through meltouts. So the salt water coming in on these coriums and on their fissionable products and coming in contact with their radioactive elements from the fuel pools is creating an endless supply of buckyballs. The nuclear plant in Japan is a perfect weapon to kill everything on the planet. It's turned itself into a bioweapon that nothing on the planet can live and coexist with. And so the urgency of the planet waking up and trying to at least stop it so that we can have half a chance is begun, right? These are from the peer-reviewed studies about this phenomenon. And this phenomenon was actually known back in the 50s and the 60s in oceanic testing. And they hid it from you. Now, these buckyballs are more deadly than a 1,000 cesium atoms. Just a single buckyball is a death sentence. But if you can get rid of the GMO, if you can eat only organic, even though it's radiated, you fill your body up with nutrients and you deny it the ability to plate up your blood, because that's what cancer does. And radiation will mutate the future if we don't even try. And if we try, rather, but if we don't try, what will it do? And, you know, the people that put us in this position that we trained and we gave all the money to and equipment and institutions, you know, how are they going to look their loved ones in the eyes? How are they going to look their children in their eyes again? How are they going to look anybody on the street in the eyes again? It's not a question or an answer that is available, I don't think, because I don't know. You know, as this planet wakes up in the next few weeks, the anger and the animosity towards them is something we have to try to coexist with, because we need them to help solve the problems, to tell us what the problem was, because it's got nothing to do with a banana, and they knew it. They know the difference. They're wonderfully educated. They have amazing amounts of accolades and certificates and degrees. And, you know, once again, you know, I sent out my best wishes to Thomas Ackerman, of course, who I absolutely love, and Kevin Blanche, who, you know, I listened to Kevin. I've heard everything Kevin, I think, has ever said at this stage. And he doesn't lie, right? I've never heard Kevin even, like, make a stupid joke. He's just factual. And you got to understand him, right, that he doesn't mean disrespect. He just doesn't have time to waste it on people because it's just too much. He just wants to share. And is that such a bad thing? It's not, right? And in the future, people will understand that. You can see that this detonation, it sprays material all over the site, and they sent in the homeless. Chernobyl, he sent in 600,000. 600,000 soldiers were conscripted to go to battle. And at Fukushima, the heroes hide away, and he sent in the most impoverished, the most uneducated, the most unarticulate, the most dependent people imaginable. And then people wonder and say, no, it's okay, Dana, they took care of everything. Please don't say that to me. Please don't disrespect me by saying that. The people that are contacting me and saying that they live at these beaches that I went and surveyed with Terry, and that they went down there and were okay, all you got to do is take a picture and go compare it. And I got nothing to gain by lying, you know. And I'm not going to yell at you. I'm not going to get upset with you. I'm not going to flash at you. I don't have that energy, you know. I'm just a little bit disheartened that you won't go look, even when I ask you. When I phone you back, you won't answer your phone. But yet you feel it's okay to try to ridicule me or embarrass me or slander me or misrepresent what I say by not going down and actually showing people that there's nothing there. By claiming that there's something there, yet not going down there and doing that, that is something you have to live with. You have to live with that. You have to live with the fact that you had an opportunity and that I got nothing to gain by telling you the truth. I don't know you, that you even exist. I'm not going to benefit off you at all. How could I? How can trying to have a debate be wrong? What is it that I done that is so wrong that you won't even get a picture to back up what you say, but yet you feel that you're entitled to try to character assassinate me? Is something you'll have to live with. I'm not going to change who I am, and I'm not going to say that it's not true when it's true, because other people there want to know. Just because you are compartmentalized and indoctrinated, I'm not going to blame you. It's not your fault, see? But you don't understand that, and you will. Let's go back over. I mean, look at number 3. Everything is missing. And Jay Cullen from the University of Victoria says there's no melter reactors. You can go watch the video a couple of videos back and link over to CBC, and he'll tell you. He don't say 3 melted reactors in the video. He say if there was reactors that were melted, it'd be a different matter. And now he's up saying that I'm lying, and he should know better, because I'm not going to take that. And we thank Pia for sending that to me. Hotmail.com, Dana Durnford at hotmail.com. And if you're going to ridicule me or accuse me, then at least have the courtesy to tell us the exact beach so we can send someone there to prove that you're actually lying. Because you are, and you know it. And all you're trying to do is have a go at me. And that's not going to change the outcome. Right? It's not going to change the outcome. Nothing is going to change the outcome. We have released the hell upon us. And it was unwillingly and unknowingly. The nuclear industry and the apologists and the lawyers and the profiteers have told you that it's like sunshine. It's like getting a bat in the ocean. You can get a bat in the ocean every day. It couldn't hurt you. I was a commercial diver. It never hurt me or anybody. I didn't see fish swimming around. My divers, we didn't have big tumors, because it's natural homeostasis radiation. And you can't get any more in your body than you already have. And if you have more ionized, man-made, these are man-made elements we talk about. They got nothing like walking in the sunshine. And so these particular elements, and I'll come back over. And I just wanted you to understand about the urethol, peroxide, sulfur, buckyballs, and just to make sure you have an opportunity to understand that there's another part of that equation that no one bothered telling you about. And all we're trying to do is help. That's all we're trying to do. You can go to the nuclear proctologist, but there's so many people below my video. There's so many people there, and they're not there for something to do. They're there because they're desperate to try to give you a reasonable opportunity to cleanse yourself of the propaganda machine and to have a real narrative to think about, to contemplate, to work with, and to not waste your time on. So you actually got a real narrative, and you can learn so much because these people have done all the legwork for you and they have your best intentions. You can imagine you haven't got radiation, right? You can't see radiation, right? Rather, but if that showed up in your coastline, you would get it. You would understand it, right? You can go down and take a picture of it. But those urethane peroxide buckyballs, you can't see those. And there was about, per reactor, about 2.2 billion times more radioactive elements and particles than all the grains of sands and all the beaches on the planet combined. I know you can't comprehend it if you're not familiar. I can't comprehend it. But if all of those microscopic radioactive elements that are floating around in our environment were different colors, we couldn't see each other. You couldn't see your finger. And there was 1,501 recorded of just cesium in California back in April and March. That was also discovered in Seattle and on the east, west coast of Canada, and a lot of the, like Boston even found them. But it was a couple of studies showed 1,500 in a cubic meter of air. Now, I don't know about you, but I breathe air, so it's pretty hard to avoid those fellers. And these people in Japan, they're breathing it all the time. And they don't, as if they haven't got enough. And the government doesn't care about them. You see all those trees? That's an island behind me. And so there's a lot of debris went into the oil, into the ocean. Right? And headed out. A lot of oil. Harsh chemicals. But what wipes out the insects on the highway for 160 kilometers of that zone? Because 40 was in boats and 160 was on the highways going to accessible places so people can go and replicate it. Popular places, provincial parks that are frequented all the time and protected, where there's people walking around and will lose their minds if you see you touch a starfish. But we don't need them anymore because there's no starfish. And it's horrific. It's unimaginable. Like the heroes, I know, but the children, folks. We look at that picture and we can't even begin to comprehend the carnage that shows up in that mind as the years go by and the reflections and the heartaches as they mature and come and start to understand what they saw and realize it. I think about those. And it's heartbreaking pictures. But it's real. And that's our life now too. You know, they were traumatized when they seen that big tsunami coming at them and all that debris. And the carnage left over behind it never stops. And that's coming here. But it's not going to be a tsunami of ocean. It's going to be a tsunami of grief and anger and misdirected trust in the system. And the system is the one that got us into this in the first place. The system has made a statement that the nuclear industry is more important than everybody. Now today I'm going to break off on that conversation as we close it down tonight. And I'm going to show you the new zodiac we're looking at, because we're going to have to spend a lot of money where it's, I don't think it's, you know, this one here is 22 feet, it's around 14,000. And it's ready to go. Don't got to do nothing. I don't got to wear myself out. I'm not going to beat myself up. And it's got still got the warranties. It's got everything else. And by the time you've done the other boat, you're looking at probably 20, 22,000, I would imagine. And so this one probably will work out to the same price. The right thing to do would be to tear that motor off the back of it and put a real brand new motor. That's a four-stroke. It's a good motor. I'm not, I can use the motor, and when it breaks, if it breaks, we can get a new one and install it and keep going. And that's fine too. But because it's 22 feet long, because it's made for every single ocean on this planet. Because we're going to go through 26,000 oceans and probably get pictures of 10,000 of them as we're going through. Because we're going into the most dangerous, the most waterless, the most loneliest, the most isolated, and the most heartbreaking, and not only radiated, but the most heartbreaking environment imaginable. I decided that I need to go bigger, I need to get smarter, I need to take my time and reevaluate everything. And of course, because I have known this coastline all my life, not all my life, but enough of my life, and worked on it so much of my life, then I'm better off. Because if we start taking people with us and more equipment with us, and or having that opportunity, we won't, our little boat won't be big enough. And if we want to bring, you know, we want to bring divers out, we want to bring reporters out, we want to bring people out that have reached out and are trying to, you know, are struggling to connect in their communities, we can pick them up and bring them out and verify what their concern was and take samples and just keep going. And at the same time, I decided when this is over, we're going to drive up to the Baltic Sea in Canada, up to the north, to Yukon, to Tuktoyaktuk, and we're going to go out into the Baltic and cover at least 500 kilometers of that coastline in the Canadian side for 30 extra days. And so we can find out definitively whether that section has been affected or impacted, and we can have a better understanding of what we're up against. And I think that is necessary. And at the same time, we'll hit rivers along the way, and we'll be taking samples and shipping samples out. I know MSVS says he's willing to take samples. We ship it off to him and photograph it. So we'll take enough samples to be able to ship them out to people and keep them, get them involved, give them something that they got the skills to really shine on. And of course, we have people out there. You know, if you got skills and you want to share it with me, and you want to, I don't know if I can use it right away, but what I'll do is I'll take a screen capture of that email, and I got a special folder, and I'll put it in that folder, and I'll have a title on it for what your skill is. And so when I need somebody with skill, I can reach out to you. And it might be months down the road, or days, or hours, or weeks, but if I can find a use for you, I'll find a use for you. And like this is an organic movement. And we got Jeff in our corner. And that's why I'm so cocky. That's why I'm so, I get all up in your face. Because I know Jeff will come through. If I got to, I'll turn to Jeff. And right now we got so many people. I better check. We got so many people that have already made their statement. You can get me at PayPal. I can see everybody out there. Finally, Dana finally gets his act together. What happened, Dana? Did somebody waterboard you and get you do it, huh? Did they waterboard you, Dana? Yeah, it's true. My doggy done it to me. My doggy's hurting. I don't know what's going on. You remember when this all happened? Now, the big thing, of course, is unimaginable, unbelievable. We are going to get you pictures that are unbelievably stunning, stunning. And it's wireless, of course, for the transfers. Just going to make life super unimaginably cool to be able to give you guys such high quality. Like, we can literally sit on a hill now and zoom in on the shoreline and get you perfect pictures. And you say, look, Dana's on the beach. No, I'm actually not. But we will. That's the idea of the Zodiac, right? Now, that's an old beater, what you're looking at. Don't get me wrong. But it's real. It's real good, too. It's solid. Everything's been serviced. And for $14,000, another $900 for a trailer, we'll have it. And we can put a little aluminum cabin on it later on if we want to, for when the weather starts getting bad. We're going up. Let's make no mistake. What me and Terry are going to do is extraordinarily tough. And trying to do it in anything, now even a 60, 70, 80 foot boat is going to be tough. Trust me. It's going to be hellish. And so the best thing to do is day trips. And this thing here, we could actually run that from right here, right up to Prince Rupert. We can carry enough fuel for a 14, 15 hour run, no problem at all on that thing. That's pretty impressive. That's impressive. And what that translates into is we can launch anywhere and we can cover the shoreline halfway to the next town or further for sure. And we could deposit gas along the way or whatever the case may be to extend our trips. But we can knock this whole thing off in 60 days, then head up to the Baltic. I think we solidify it once and for all. We take away their wiggle room. Not that they're going to have any, because they're going to try to blame the death of the Pacific Ocean on a pathogen or something like that. But they can't blame the death of all the other creatures, every species, and on top of that, all the insects, even the bacteria in the coastline. It's all gone. The ocean comes in, it dries up, and it doesn't leave anything. It doesn't smell when the tide goes out. In 85 and 19, 95 degrees temperature, day after day after day. No flies, no insects, no sea anemones, no 60, 70 species of sea anemones or anything else. And so I think everybody should feel really good that we're going to go and get this one instead and take a few extra days, because you can feel much safer. You know, this one is Coast Guard grade. This is the real deal. It's meant to get up and do its job over and over and over. The engine hasn't been run hard because it was a big investment. It sat around for a long time because they didn't get the business. And then they finally traded it in and just went into tourism again with a different type of operation. And so that's why I decided, okay, actually, I'm willing to switch out, because we can carry a load of people, a load of equipment. We can travel long distances. And this thing was there for the long run, including the Northwest Territories. We have to go up and find out, is it sneaking down the back door? We have to know what the shape of life is up there. And same as we're going for broke, there's no reason to stop. We might as well get up there, get it out of the way, because the winter is coming. You won't be able to do this, right? We got to get it finished before winter, because you could get stuck for 30 days in Pion Islands if we're not careful. But lucky for me, I know the entire coastline. We have the support, the equipment, the skills, the determination, and we have the ambition to get the job done. And if we don't, then you can all walk down to the beach the next morning and take a picture, and you take away whatever they tried to, right? Okay, folks, we say goodnight to everybody. MSVS, Sean Can't Surf, Rad Chick, hi honey, hugs, Radioactive Banana. What should we name the boat? I think we should name the boat the Hounds of Fukushima. That's mine, right? Thank you, Tracy. Yeah, me too, Tracy. Sean Can't Surf, Delamine, Ellie, Kate, Chyna, Adam, Ronald McKnight. We're saying goodnight to everybody. We appreciate it. Like I said, we just wanted to run through a bunch of stuff, get up here and just put out a video to keep the momentum. It's not hard now for me to do it. You guys, you know, I just feel like I'm protected, that the job is going to get done, and that we have what it takes at this stage to say that, yes, this is happening. It really, truly is. I still can't believe it, that we're going to do this and put an end to this friggin' first part of the nightmare. And then they can listen to us, and then they can learn, and then we can try. But if we don't try, then what was the sense of the human race in the first place, right? It's because we try. That's what we do. That's what we're notorious for. There's nothing that's going to stop us. They don't have a leg to stand on, and that we don't have any fear anymore, because we don't have the option and we don't have the time, and we're not asking for much, and your support is just the reality. See, it doesn't matter that it's just trickling in. It's trickling in, and we got more radio interviews coming up. We done Dr. Bill Deagle. He's hard to cut in on, My goodness. I never thought I'd meet anybody who can talk more than I can. But there you go. And that's cool, though. Just to get out there and so people can hear it. It was another opportunity for people to find us. I don't care, right? Even though I only get a minute on somebody's radio show and I got to sit there for 4 hours, I will sit there for that 4 hours. I'll be multitasking. But I'll be sitting there waiting. I have no issues with that. Okay, folks. Hugs for everybody. Original Punisher, once again, you know, thank you for your support and the things that you do. I don't think people really appreciate who you are and how good of a soul you truly are. We are going to change that. We will change that definitively, I can assure you, because you're one of the better ones. You're the best friend we got in the sense of you always put yourself out front, right? And that's so appreciated. You don't hide away. Your name is always dear. And you always put your money where your mouth was when you open it. That, my friend, is admirable, admirable, and you don't see many people like it. And I hope that, you know, people can learn, and they are, and they have. And there's many of you out there who have supported me. I'm just saying, somebody who, even though doesn't have any obligations, has decided no matter what, even if everything fails, we still have a backup plan, and that we can count on at least one person guaranteed will see this through besides us. We're so fortunate, and that we need so much more. We need so much equipment and so many teams doing this by rights, so many people. And it's unimaginable that we got one up on that nasty nuclear industry that we can now hold them to justice. We just need another 65 or 70 days, and they have no pensions, and they have to come on board and help us try to reverse things. You couldn't hope for any better than that. You know, it's literally co-opting them so that everybody don't destroy them, right? They still have something to offer. We have to consider that. Try not to turn against them. Try to turn them into useful idiots instead of the useless idiots and the destructive ones at that. Hugs for everybody. Dana loves you. Dana respects you. You showed me what you're made of, and you changed the game for everybody. Truly something else, folks. You're really, truly something. Take you. And we'll see you tomorrow night again, of course. And we'll have a lot of good news for you tomorrow night. My apologies to anybody that I missed. I can't keep up with it, but I'll try my best. You can call me. You'll find my number at the nuclearproctologist.org. Take care, folks.